Hey guys, it's me again. Well, I gave you a list of shows that I didn't like, but everyone else loves and enjoys and praises, but I figured let's put things on the flip side and do a show about shows that I love, but not everyone else loves so much. This one was a little harder to put together compared to the hate list. It's not that I hate more shows, I think it's because with this list, I wanted to put on shows that I felt like had actual significant following and enough critical praise balance where it feels like it is at least evenly set to one side or the other. And because I tend to follow a lot more cult shows, a lot more lesser-known titles compared to everyone else, yeah, I wanted to avoid those kind of shows that, you know, maybe only like 30 people saw. You know, and people didn't like it because it was a little strange to them. I mean, every show's gonna be strange to somebody, I get it, but again, I wanted to pick shows that had a little more, at least more of a chance, or at least more of a following to be disliked or liked. So, it was a lot harder to put this one together, but I think I did a fair enough job, so you probably won't see nearly as many, but let's just get on with the list. Murder Princess. Of course, I reviewed the show already. You know I love it. You know it's on my favorite list. So, and this one I had to debate whether or not I wanted to include it, but I figured it has a Funimation release. Sure, why not? So, you know, this was 2007 little OVA, you know, and kind of a quirky title even for this list, again, because it's not super streamlined or discussed, you know, like the show, like a lot of other shows. It's just kind of one of those little OVAs that kind of came and went in back then it got licensed instantly by, not instantly, actually it was licensed by ADV Films, then got picked up by Funimation real quickly. But I wanted to include it just because, in terms of its weighted scores at other sites like Anime News Network, you know, which I usually find tend to be a lot more higher than a lot of other sites like, say, My Anime List. And just in general, how it even fares against some of my own fellow fans and my own friends even. You know, when it comes to the show, me, I'm like, wow, this show's great, I love it. They're like, they'll either be like, eh, that's okay. Or, nah, I don't really like it that much. That's how my friends are, honestly, with the show. You know, and in some cases, some anime, and this is a general statement, there are some anime that end up being so short, they just severely fall short of any potential or greatness. But then there are others that go on for too damn long and don't deserve it. And I would love a full series treatment of this show. I absolutely would. You know, but as it is, it's a great little 6-episode OVA. You know, it's not so short, it's not so crazy, it's not so hectic. Like, a lot of times you get these, like, little short one-off OVAs based off of a popular manga, and it's just like, well, what the hell was that all about then? I guess because they're usually like backdoor pilots for TV shows, but obviously the OVA doesn't perform well because, well, the OVA is covering such a small snippet of the manga, so it's kind of just a self-suicide if you ask me, but whatever. But, you know, it's a super action, fast-paced show, and it's kind of unlike, you know, the studio they trained, which was very much known for their very slow, moving, very story-driven shows like Noir, like Dot Hack, you know, which everybody loves to criticize. You know, this one was so very fast-paced, but unlike another show that was very fast-paced, which was another manga adaptation called Blade of the Immortal, which was a much more popular manga, so I don't understand why that got such a short treatment. This doesn't feel so crazy and hectic that I lose track of what's going on. When I watched a show like Blade, I was bewildered and just, it was like I was being bombarded with so much information in the first episode. And while this, yes, kind of bombards you a little bit, it's mostly action and it still takes time, it still takes a breath, it still will take that moment to slow down, give our characters some time together, give some chemistry building, and, you know, we even get to see their growing pains, kind of, you know, when Alita upsets Milano and the two have a fight, but of course they care so much for each other that they still go and rescue each other, they still help each other, so that's why I like it. You know, the character's great, and it's a short little fun piece. It would be great with more, but, you know, as it is. You know, and the ratings, especially like places like Anime News Network, it wasn't very full of praise, you know, and the scores are about average as far as anything kind of goes for OVAs. You know, and there's one critic critique by Carl Kimlinger, but he hates anything by the studio, so what are you gonna do? Oh, Tsubasa Chronicle. Oh, yes, once again. And yeah, I'm wearing the shirt again. Of course, here's another series I gave a flip review for, and I enjoyed it. Now, I think the first series was, of course, a lot better than the second, and if there had been a third, maybe it could have regained some ground, could have gotten a little more kind of more interesting. You know, the second series didn't have nearly as many interesting episodes, but maybe a third series would have regained some ground there. You know, and oh my, and wow, manga fans hate this show so much. They say it's a butchering, and they say it's a hack job, but it's not. It's not. Half of TRC's already a gotta-catch-em-all plot. And yeah, some of the filler episodes could have been fitted into early chapters in the manga. You know, I guess the one major exception is the resurrection plot. And at first, I understand now. Well, it took a reason. I'm recently started rewatching it again, so I understand now where the, you know, you can't raise the spirits of the dead. But if you truly want an adaptation that disregards the source material entirely, I suggest you go look at this anime called Eat Man from 1997, and that has absolutely nothing to do with that manga. I've never even seen the show or read that manga, but it's got Yuki Kajira's music in it, and I love her. And yeah, I know the Tsubasa series gets darker, the stakes get higher, things get a little more violent, and of course with the disputes between Clamp and the production companies, and you know, that's where all the disagreements obviously kind of stemmed from, was Clamp wanted to finally push the series into the dark direction, but the network still wanted their more kid-friendly fare because they had produced Cardcaptor Sakura in the past, and they wanted the Sakura fans, so they were kind of looking for their next big kid show, and I guess that's understandable. I've seen some people say the fight scenes were not realistic in this anime. Like, they were realistic in the manga? Really? It's like Shaoran's practically a Mary Sue with his martial arts skills. I know it's saying he is. I know where he gets his martial arts skills from. It's not like he has them from the hell out of nowhere, but the kid's an archaeologist. He's an archaeologist. He's not freaking Chuck Norris or Bruce Lee. At least I don't think he is. So, I think the show gets a little more hate than it deserves. Some of the episodes unfortunately are padded to hell with flashbacks, but unfortunately, it's kind of that thing you can only blame on the really bad production schedule that the network gave. You know, 6 months between seasons is ridiculous. You know, the director had said it before in a different interview that it's nearly impossible to get theatrical quality style animation in a 6 month period. And so, you know, it's a good show. Is it super amazing and awesome? No, you know, there definitely are elements the manga probably does a little better. It's been a while since I've read it, but, you know, I do remember liking the manga fine, and I certainly like the anime, but I gotta say, Clamp fans have started to turn me off from the manga that I don't want to ever continue. Digimon Frontier. This is the fourth series in the Digimon franchise, and frankly, it's the last I ever watched. Because there's just never been a series that's gotten as good as the three original series. Well, the three others, I should say. You know, a lot of people definitely disliked the series because it didn't have the Digimon partners, and they just transformed right into their Digimon. But I thought this was such a welcome change. It was a new way to turn the story. And, you know, and I just didn't have a problem with it. You know, I didn't have a problem with the past, with the partners and all. The partners always had a charm and great elements to the series, of course. But I think, obviously, with Pokemon always being in Digimon's shadow, well, actually, it's always Digimon being in Pokemon's shadow, but, you know, with these two shows always kind of competing neck and neck, you know, I think this is what I think Frontier is what made it really stand out the most in terms of the Mon Wars, which were starting to really taper off by this time. Hell, I even remember almost brushing Digimon off as a Pokemon clone way back then, way back when the first series was gaining steam in America because of just how similar certain aspects were. Of course, I ended up loving Digimon so much. Now, regarding the transformations humans into Digimon, if Digimon was the type of show where we really came to see the monsters, I could see this being a problem. But ever since day one, it's been just as much about the children as the monsters as well. Oh, I mean, sure, maybe this series could have gone into some depth about the kids having to learn how to trust their spirit partners, you know, something they can't see, or, you know, like, compared to having the Agumon at your side, you have to trust that there's this Digimon spirit that's going to protect you from this big, scary monster. Yeah, sure, we could have done something like that, but I guess it's a kid's show. You probably can't expect too much deep out of that. But, you know, and this is what kept it from becoming a Pokemon, kept being a Pokemon clone was. And all Digimon series were like this, of course, was, you know, the fighting was, you could say, a mostly equal partnership. I mean, still, the Digimon had to do all the fighting, and the kids had to kind of give the orders, but I think Seasons 3 and this season did it much better about how to make this an equal partnership between your monster and you, I guess. And I remember everybody dumping on Tamers Season 3 before it debuted. And everybody was really shitting on that series. And of course, everybody today says, oh, it was the best Digimon ever! Rightfully so, there's a lot of great elements to Tamers. But I think Frontier is sorely underrated as far as Digimon goes. And I gotta say, looking back, I just don't like Season 2 that much. Another time, though. Ponyo. I guess. Let's go into the work of Hayao Miyazaki. Ponyo is definitely the one a lot of people don't like. I find when it comes... I guess that or Howl's Moving Castle, but with Howl's Moving Castle, I find it's mostly people who loved the novel, didn't like the movie. But as far as Ponyo goes, I think this one's really, really mixed with critics. And obviously, Miyazaki's seen as this masterful storyteller. He can tell these deep and complex and emotional stories, and that's fine. And he can. He can do those well. You know, we've seen it with Spirited Away. We've seen it with Mononoke. But I liked Ponyo. I liked the simple charm of Ponyo. It's the Little Mermaid, but better. The Disney Little Mermaid, anyway, not the actual Hans Christian Andersen story, which is much darker and more sad. But Ponyo is a really cute and innocent show, and it's great for everybody, really. And I think too many people dump on it because of that, because it's for kids, therefore it's not good. True art is serious. Yeah, I think it's a lot of true art, serious art critics and straw men kind of they know Miyazaki as this Inception-esque Nolan storyteller who will just tell these really bizarre, complicated stories. And again, those are fine, but I think it's nice when even Miyazaki can kind of take a breather and just have fun with a little movie. not have to be, every movie essentially, because he always seems to vow retirement, he always tends to like make movies like his magnum opus. And if anything's a magnum opus for Miyazaki, it's definitely The Wind Rises. But, Ponyo wasn't that. It felt like it wasn't like, okay, this is it. This is going to be my great grand exit. Oh, well, I'm bored. I want to go back and make another movie now. Let's face it, the man vows retirement too often. And Ponyo was a sweet and cute and little innocent story, and it's absolutely great for kids and families alike. It's not, obviously it's not a dumbed down movie by any stretch of the imagination. It's a very, it still has that, Miyazaki adult charm to it, right? Where it still is appealing to that older audience. But I just think because he probably went a little younger in with the audience this time compared to probably something like Spirited Away, which, I'm sure kids can enjoy, but, or Mononoke even, that, a lot of people just didn't like it. And I loved it. Neon Genesis, The End of Evangelion.
It always comes back to Ava, doesn't it?
Oh boy. This one's a can of worms. Okay, Evangelion is one of the series I like it. I understand why people don't like it. And I understand why people don't like The End of Evangelion either. It's one of those, it's just a quirky, kooky series, and it's got so much hype, you just draw your line in the sand. You either like it or you don't, that's fine. And again, with The End of Evangelion, I really understand why. I mean, even Ava fans, I think, hate this movie as well. Up until Ava 3.0 pissed everybody off. That's what Anno likes to do, he likes to piss people off. I think Star 6 Wars 1... I can't remember exactly what he said, but he did put it pretty well with this movie. It's sadistic and it's brutal. I'm totally guessing, I'm totally paraphrasing here, but... And he's right. It is. It's a sadistic and brutal movie. And I guess that's kind of why I liked it in some weird, strange way. I normally don't like the sadist shows, like Elf and Lied or the torture porn horror films like Saw. I don't like them. And... I can't, but I guess why I liked The End of Ava was, it don't feel like it was torture porn, just, it was apocalyptic. There are so many mecha shows out there, and so many of them are post-apocalyptic. Oh hell, post-apocalyptic genre is out there, period. It's so overdone, and it's so overused. It's like, everything's always after the end, after the end, after the end. It's always the desolate landscape, or the post-technological terror society. And I know that's Evangelion's setting too, but in terms of actually creating an apocalypse and creating a doomsday scenario, this one works. There's not many shows that actually show the fall, the end, the death, they always show the aftermath. They never show the actual, what actually brings the end to a civilization. And that's what this movie did, and that's why I liked it for that. It was dark, and it was sadistically scary in so many ways, and it was damn intense, and I understand the director's state of mind at the time. He's, like, seriously depressed and ready to kill himself. He never did, of course. I get why people don't like it, but I like it for that strange, quirky reason. It is dark and it is depressing. And honestly, it feels like an end. It feels like a dark, unsatisfying end to all humanity. It makes no fucking sense whatsoever, and I love it for that. I don't need it to make sense. Considering by the end of the series, they pretty much ran out of all their money and had to kind of do whatever the hell they could do just to fill the remaining episodes, that's, the series kind of goes off on its weird tangent, and then this movie goes off on a tangent. I don't know. It's just this weird, quirky love-hate relationship with this movie. So that's my list of animes that I particularly like, but not so many else, not so many other people do. As always, share in the comments of shows you liked, and vice versa. You can even tell me I'm an idiot and say all the shows I like are stupid. It's your opinion, I'm not gonna stop you. So, until next time guys, Shadow Blazer, signing off.